I was born in Jamestown, North Dakota, 1918, August 20. My dad was a farmer in North Dakota as a result of beginning World War I. His dad found out that his sons wouldn't go to war if they were raising crops to feed America. So he actually went out and bought farms and put his sons out there. My dad was learning to be a farmer, and he was getting a kick out of it. And then when the war broke up, well, among other things, the price of grain went down and all kinds of economic problems, in a sense. My dad left that and went into oil business.
Were you raised on a farm, or were you raised in town?
That was my recollection of being raised was in town, not on a farm. But I had 3 summers of farm work going to my uncle's in North Dakota from Jamestown. Well, at that time I was leaving Moorhead, Minnesota. The family was living there. And I'd go down to my uncle's, hitchhike over gravel roads, wagon, hay wagons for some of the ride, automobiles or trucks for other parts of the ride to get down to Oaks, North Dakota from Fargo, North Dakota. And I'd spend the whole summer down there and having a ball for me, a city kid. I loved working with my uncle's horses, even the milking of the cows.
And you know, talk about living in that that small little town. You know, what did kids do for fun in the summers and things like that? I mean, you went to the farm on some of these summers, but you know, when you were in town and on the weekends, what kind of stuff did you do in that era?
In that time? Well, I'd say the young people, I'm trying to remember age level. I expect there to be 9, 10 years old that I'd be associating with other boys. And we had a little gang of 2 people, 3 people, and then 2 blocks away would be another one, and we'd go over there and challenge them to how far, who could throw the stone the furthest, who could climb a fence the fastest, things like that. More than once, could we jump over that mud puddle? And of course, we didn't all succeed, and we'd get in there and they'd all laugh. Our parents wouldn't be too happy, mothers essentially. But that, and then there was organized, in our own fashion, organized baseball games.
It sounds like an outdoor childhood.
Oh yeah, much of it is outdoors.
Were you an athletic kind of kid? I mean, you liked sports and liked running around.
I liked the companionship of the other guys and that, and I wanted to do what they did, and I would say that was the biggest thing. And we're always jumping up and getting on a branch limb of a tree and trying to chin ourselves, and then, well, I can do better than that. And you'd go back up and try again. Then he'd try and outdo you again. And stuff like that went on and on. Or even climbing high up in a tree. One mother come out and told her son, just stay there, I'm going to get the fire department. And she did. Come out there and says, you kids are just crazy. You can't do things like that happen all the time. You know, little things like that. And all of a sudden it was supper time, all of a sudden it was bedtime. And it seemed to me, especially on vacation, summer vacation, they went awful fast all the time.
You know, when you walk into a classroom full of children, there's all the personalities. There's the quiet kid, mm-hmm. there's the intellectual kid, there's the loud kid, there's the joker kid, all the personalities. If we'd walked into your classroom, which kid were you?
I was always getting called up because I was doing something different. I remember one time I was making paper stand on end, another piece over the top. It was heavy paper, and I could do that. The next kid says, well, I can do that. And this was in a Catholic school, and the nun says, what are you boys up to? Well, I'm trying to do what Jake, they call me James then, James is doing here. Sister said, did you start that? You know. Next day it'd be something with the eraser. I'd be up at the blackboard and I'm waiting for somebody to finish something, then I'd be doodling on it. I was always doing something. The nun was correcting me, but the class would laugh because it was kind of a crazy, clownish type of stunt.
You know, did the Depression affect your family?
Oh, yes.
How so?
Well, Mother would report to us every 2 weeks when Dad got paid how much money she'd saved from the last 2 weeks' paycheck. Right off the bat. And what did that mean? That mean if we wanted a new shirt or new shoes, or the essential things, it'd be that much longer or closer to have enough money to get it. Then we made, and I think at that time everybody was thinking that way. 2 pennies was a lot of money. My father had passed away, and the company that hired him hired me as soon as I graduated from high school in 36. And I got $25 a month less than my dad did. And inside, by the time Pearl Harbor, I was earning the same money my father was. And I was the sole support of my brother and 2 sisters and my mother.
And were you single at that time?
Oh, yeah. Mm.
And so, do you remember hearing the news in December 1941 that Pearl Harbor had been attacked?
Yes.
How did it impress you at that point? What was your reaction?
My reaction was, we'll have to hear from the government. The radio stations had a big effect then. Everybody's listening to the radio for everything. And the attitude was, don't worry, Franklin Delano Roosevelt will take it under wing and all this, but we got to listen to him first. And Congress passed the declaration of war against Japan.
A day that will live in infamy.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you get a sense, I mean, you know, the country was at war. Did you get a sense you were going to get called up at some point?
Oh, yes. Well, the draft had already been in effect, and some of my buddies were in. And the National Guard from our hometown was called up. Oh, it must have been put on active duty status sometime around Thanksgiving in 1940.
Tell us then how did you get into the Army?
Oh, well, that was another thing. In 1926, or whenever it is, when Lindbergh flew across the ocean, a lot of stories. I was selling papers. My father was still living in that. I was selling papers, and my goal was I wanted to be a pilot. I wanted to get into flying. And I was probably 10 years old. And other kids said, oh, you can't afford an airplane. Anyway, that was my goal. And when the war broke out, I'd already looked into aviation cadet status as soon as I got out of high school. But you couldn't get into aviation cadet status without having a college degree at that time, 37, the first time I looked at it. Anyway, so I was, when my father passed away in 38, 3 months later, we were in, back in Moorhead, where we started from, my dad started from, working for Minneapolis Moline, and they transferred him as manager to this branch. Passed away, and then they hired me. But I had to go to Moorhead, to Fargo to work in their parts department. That's when I started to go to night school. Three colleges there. I went to Moorhead State Teachers College at that time. picking up credits so I could get eligible, maybe, to get into the Army Air Corps. Okay. Then the war broke. That changed everything. In February, four of us took time off, whatever we were doing, went down to Minneapolis on a Wednesday. We didn't know what we were going to do or what, but we were all going to go to the recruiting offices down there because they were had notes on the paper and everything else. We all wanted to be in the Air Force. Other than the four of us, two of us were qualified. They sent us home with a letter to our draft board saying, Jake Simonitsch is eligible for cadet flying status training. Defer calling him. And call this number if you gotta, you know, if you're gonna call. Because they wanted me first. Mm-hmm. And we finally got word, come down, we'll swear you in. And so I went down in June. The other fellow went down in July, I think. We were on our own answering to things. And when I got down, I raised my right hand and I was in the service. I was in the Air Corps Reserve. Couldn't be touched by anybody but Air Corps. About 2 months later, being in the reserve, I had to report for training, but I'd be notified and it would happen in 90 days. In other words, in reserve, you had to be some kind of unit and you had to have monthly training, like the National Guard. Well, that never happened because the next thing I got was orders to report for active duty in October of 42. In November of 42, found me in the Army in San Antonio Aviation Cadet Center. All of us that was in my group went down out of Minneapolis to, what's it called, we were all flying training qualified. And there was people and kids from all over the place. But they were from North Dakota, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and South Dakota. And they all come into Minneapolis, and we had a four-car train, nothing but aviation cadets going to San Antonio. Next stop in Des Moines, Iowa, we picked up two more cars, and on top of that, we put more, all the cars got more. If they had a capacity for 60 passengers, they probably had 70.
So a whole train load
and when
of future
we got past,
pilots. A whole train load of future pilots.
That's right, right. And everybody on that was the same way. Well, anyway, we had another night or two. The train was steady going. It stopped to take on water, I think. They stopped to change crews was one of the things. That's when they'd water and they'd be on the ground. We could all leave the train if we wanted to. Occasionally, we'd leave somebody behind. And guess what? They found out from the station where the train was going. And then they hitchhiked and met the train further down the road. I remember we stopped the train for one guy to board the train to meet this San Antonio deadline.
Well, what happened when he got to San Antonio?
San Antonio, we were in what they call Aviation Cadet Center, and they must have had, well, you got one of them here, World War II barracks over there at Pima. That kind of a building, 82 aviation cadets in that building, all waiting for assignment to pre-flight training. And we had to do physical and skill there, and another one before we were released for flight training. In other words, could we see? Were our teeth all there? All kinds of odd things. On top of that, we were told for 30 days we'll remain as a group, and when we went out, the sergeant would take us out, and we had to learn to march, and give us some marching instructions. And if we went to eat, we had to go to eat as a group and everything else. We were all under quarantine. This whole train load was, you know, and there were barracks all over the place with them. The barracks next to us, they were on their sixth week, and it was half empty because all the people had filled different quotas going to different schools. And by the time our first month was up, that barracks was empty and open for another. Anyway, we went to the mess hall, ate on our own at the mess hall. Now, I don't know how many people there were, but all the mess halls had constantly had quarantined people. Before our quarantine was up, two guys came down with the mumps. We started another quarantine. That took us up to Christmas Eve, I think, or something. A week before that ended up, four guys come down with the mumps. Another quarantine starts. And I don't know how many weeks later, another one come down. So we were constantly starting 30 days, and we were getting kind of fed up with this stuff. And we were getting kind of sassy, too, to the sergeants and the rest of them. They couldn't do anything to us because we were restricted in what we could do. When we went to the theater, they put on a movie special for us. Might be at 9 o'clock in the morning or 4 in the afternoon. Everything. We went to the hospital for shots, which we had to do. Everything was cleared. And then there'd be another group, but they couldn't come any closer than a block away from us. So when we cleared our shots up, they could come up, but they were under quarantine too.
Well, tell me what happened, because you ended up as a navigator.
This is it. We were going through all this quarantine stuff. 80% of the 80, about 60 of us or more, were qualified for flying training, navigator, bombardier, or pilot. In February, they called 14 of us out. They needed to fill a quota. We found that out later. You're all qualified for pilot training, navigator training, bombardier training. We have some quotas to fill. First off, we got to have 8 people for navigation school. The reason you people are here, you've all had mumps, according to the records. The doctors say you're not, will no longer be a carrier, or you will not come down.
You're immune.
Yeah, you're immune. Yeah. Then that's how I got in, because I was going to be a pilot. When I got into this thing, he says, don't worry, you people, you can always get your, within a year, you can put in for pilot training. What a bunch of, anyway, within a year, I was in combat.
So when did you find out you were going to be a navigator then?
Well, when they passed out, they said, out of the 14 or 16 of us, 4 of them didn't want to go unless they're going to be a pilot. The rest of us, we had a chance right now to go to bombardier school and navigation school. And most of us wanted to go to bombardier school because they didn't figure it was required as much intelligence to get graduated and get commissioned. Then I said, heck, I'll go to navigator school. Are you sure, Sergeant? Yeah. Within a year and a half after this, you're qualified. You can still go to pilot school. Pilot training. Of course, that never happened. Well, that was it. That's where my life started.
So you went off to navigation training?
School, yeah. I joined a bunch of people and went there. And these other people, and I'd been on active duty 3 months. The group I joined had been on active duty a little over 45 days. I've been on duty longer.
Did you find the navigation training difficult?
No.
So you took to it then?
Yeah. Didn't remind me for when I started doing stars and the rest of the stuff. It reminded me of my Boy Scout days.
Did you actually like it?
Oh yeah, I didn't have any. I wasn't the sharpest navigator, but I. Well, the beat list laying in the barracks day after day, which I hadn't had up to that time.
When you completed that navigation training, did you get your wings then after that?
Yeah, yeah.
That must have been a proud day.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's what we were all aiming for. We wanted to be officers and be flying officers.
Well, you're an officer, you're a navigator. Talk about getting then together with a crew. How did that happen?
Well, my orders were to report to someplace, Ephrata, Washington, I think, for crew assemblies, I guess. That's so, to report to, what you call it, for crewing up or something like that. It was the formal thing. But as I said, that you're going out there and... What does it mean? Well, it means they got some pilots there, and they got some navigators and radio operators and gunners, and they put 10 of you together to make up a crew for a B-17. And I said, okay.
What was your impression of the B-17? What was your feeling about being assigned to the 17?
Well, I thought I was exhilarated, really what. By the way, while... The last year in high school, my dad told me it was going to be a farmer flying up to Mandan for the opening of the Mandan Airport. And he says you ask him at school, I'll give you permission, but you got to ask him at school, you can skip school for the day to go over there to get this ride, which I did. And that was my first flight there. I sat in an open cockpit biplane with my right foot on a man's hat so it wouldn't blow away, and I think he got air sick, but I was reaching over the side most of the time looking about where we're going next.
So you were hooked.
I saw Lindbergh's, I've mentioned that earlier, I saw Lindbergh in a parade in Fargo, North Dakota, and I must have been 8 years old. I don't remember exactly, but I got real close to him at a meeting in Moorhead, but I was a kid. So I didn't get up to shake his hand or anything else. He came over to meet Chamber of Commerce or something because Minnesota was his state.
Well, you're in Washington. The crew is coming together.
Yeah. You looked at the bulletin board and it'd tell you. And it said, little notices up. These navigators are next to be allocated or assigned to crews.
When you started flying then as a crew, were you flying the FF model of through the B-17?
Yes, yes.
So there was no chin turret
on
it?
No chin turret, no.
And how long was it then before you got over to Europe at that point?
Well, I got in Europe, I'm real hazy about that, but sometime at the end of October, beginning of November. And this had to be, I got into Ephrata sometime in September. And I had 18 hours flying time in a B-17. When I got with the rest of the navigators to come over with me, I had a lot of experience. Most of them had 6 hours.
Wow. Who was your pilot?
Paul Quillen. And he was from Minnesota. I was from Minnesota.
Did you fly over to Europe or take a ship?
No, we went over on the big ship, Queen Elizabeth.
What stands out in your mind as far as that journey over to Europe?
On the ship?
Yeah.
That we didn't have any escort, and we were out running submarines, and the bridge, according to the officer that I talked to, written in the log, that they'd discover a submarine approximately a mile away, surfaced. And I think they thought it was a German submarine. Mm-hmm. But the ship was way too fast for submarines, mm-hmm. especially if they were submarines were submerged. So we didn't have any, we had 2 days of storm, and no as much of a storm.
How did you pass the time?
Oh, I don't know, there was a lot of gambling. But what I did is they had a library. I spent a lot of time in their library looking at the books that the tourists used to read. And I don't remember what books I read at the time, but then listed men said that scholars, the Navigator Simonitsch is a scholar, but don't pull that stuff on us.
Well, you arrived safe and sound in England?
In England, and up in Edinburgh someplace, Glasgow, Scotland. And we took a train there down to an airport, Air Force School. I slept two nights there, and the third night, or the third on the third day, our crew was loaded with other crews on a truck and drove for hours, ended up, in our case, at 390th.
What'd you remember, what'd the base look like? What'd you think of the place?
Well, I had no idea what to expect. And as far as I was concerned, it had airplanes and they were flying and I was going to fly. By the way, I was the oldest man on the crew and I was the craziest one about flying.
How old were you?
Well, when I got over, let's see, I'd say 24 or 25. The pilot was 19, I think. Co-pilot was 18. Bombardier was 20. And the two sergeants were, I was still the oldest guy in the ship. One of them was 23 and the other one was 22. Mm-hmm. And the rest of the group was under 21. They weren't eligible to drink any place that I know of in the States, but that didn't stop them. My first bombing mission was to Emden on the 11th of December.
In 1943?
43, right. Mm. Oh, before that, here's something. Colonel Witten, the group commander, met privately with each crew. And he came over and his aide came over, I don't remember who that was anymore, and shook hands with us, and we saluted him and everything else, and they sat down, real Air Force, not very formal. And I remember, he says, told us we'd do this and that. I said, if you want to know when you're going to fly, the flagpole will have a red flag. And then we select crews, and the crew is immediately notified. So, and I was sleeping in a barracks with the officers for four crews, ours and three others. So the red flag had come up, go up by the squadron headquarters. So the first thing the pilots would do is, at least one pilot, well, four pilots of the crews, come back to the barracks and a little piece of paper, stick it on the door. Quillen's flying tomorrow. Quillen and Quackenbush are flying the next day, or stuff like that, see? And that's how we got learned when we're going to fly. In the meantime, they had us oriented. Well, we had to go to supply and get the right kind of flying suit. I kept asking what I want to do with my navigation books I took with me. From what I can see, I won't be shooting stars on these here. Because they briefed us, and Witten did too, that all our rays are daytime. And you don't need a bunch of navigation books, which they gave me out of graduating school. So I don't know what the Air Force did or Air Corps did with that, but I took it over to supply and got a piece of paper from them that I turned them in and never saw them again.
Well, are you anticipating the first, what's your feeling as you're coming up on the first mission? I mean, was it excitement? Was it fear? Was it, I don't know, what were
you? Mostly, in my particular case, the bombardier used to tell me I'm crazy. I was anticipating. Mm. And I had no idea what was going to go on or anything. The bombardier says, "You don't, dumb navigator, not smart enough to know you should be scared." That was his impression. He was a cool customer in a way. Anyway, that was the way I felt about it. And for my money, I'd say most of the crew members, they'd gone on their first mission, everything else, they knew anything could happen, but they volunteered for it. Now let's go and see what we can make of it.
Well, so that first mission is to Emden. Tell us about, that's your first
my
combat.
First mission. Well, we were alerted, we were one of the three spares, and our spare position was number three. So if an airplane in the group would fall out before they reached the coast or whatever it was, number one would go. And if another one fell out, then we would go, I guess, as far as we dared, but supposedly not more than, there was higher headquarters. They didn't want us out over the enemy territory, which is the French coast was. But some of our spares flew that far and finally got a mission in. Anyway, in our particular case, the raid to Emden, we were with the group, and somebody in the formation peeled out and went back, and we flew, and we flew, and we flew, and the lead number one spare didn't take the spot. Number three, my pilot says, we're going to take it. So we flew in. Guess what the position was? Number two in the lead, the group lead formation. And we got in there, and everything was happy. The radio operator understood from communications that I guess we lost two more airplanes than the other spares filled in, that everything was okay with the group, because somebody was sending a message back. He could, whatever the okay sign was, he got it, and he said, "We used all the spares, they're all with us," and so on. We went in, and at a certain time, we're supposed to get fighters, and about a minute later, we're supposed to coast in. Well, I was telling them, looks to me like we're going to be within 20 seconds of coast in. And just before that, we're supposed to see our fighter escort. And the bombardier said, "Oh, there's fighters right there." And I look at my watch and I says, "Well, right on time." Guess what? They were German fighters attacking us. Major Hansel's crew was lead. I don't know who was flying with Major Hansel, but the fighters hit him first and knocked his airplane down. Now, being number two, we were supposed to be the next brand new spanking, and I told the pilot, says, "What do you know about the lead?" And I says, "We're up front, hang on to the airspeed. And I says, "We're on course. And we got so many minutes to go, about 5 minutes to go, and we're going to hit an IP or something, and then head into the sub."
The target.
The target was Sub Pens at Emden, I think. I don't remember anymore exactly. And I got it all clocked out, and everything's working fine. But I watched the I watched Major Hansel get out of the window of his airplane and be hanging on to the side, reaching for the wing. And I thought he was reaching in for a parachute. I don't know. The next thing I know, he's gone off the wing. And the co-pilot witnessed the same, well, he thought he witnessed the same thing. He talked, at debriefing, he talked first. And I said, "Yeah, I saw that. And he talked kind of iffy. I said, "I can confirm it." I found out about 5 years ago that the Germans picked up Major Hansel's body on the coast.
Are you saying when the lead plane got knocked down, your plane
then, the lead,
you went into the lead position?
We didn't. The pilot wanted to know we're in the lead position just like you do. I told him, we're on schedule, we're on heading, don't change a thing, the group will go with us.
So by default, you became the lead navigator on your first mission?
Yeah. But when I got to debriefing, the number three crew got credit for the lead. Why? Because you don't have a brand spanking new... You don't tell 8th Air Force, whoever it is, this is what the pilot was told. And the co-pilots matter no ops. If he's ever going to be first pilot, those kind of things count. He was more military-oriented than I was. So if we got lead by default, he says, on my first mission, that'd be pretty good, wouldn't it?
I don't
think we ever got credit for the lead, but what I told him, don't change to anything. We don't have time.
So what happened after that then?
Well, we got over the target, emptied our bombs. I think we lost three airplanes. I don't know. I have to look in the blue book to see. But
did the American fighters ever show up?
Oh, yeah, but they were a little late. Mm. But we turned on the... See, I was giving him the headings, and we assumed everybody was following us. And as we made things... By the way, we did a little zigging to get on the right heading and on the right time for coast, what they called coast in. And of course, that was the lead navigator. All I was doing is logging how we were doing, and we were within, I was within 5 seconds of whatever he was thinking. But he was running the show. And my idea was, we don't have time to figure out who's going to start and everything else. When the bombardier said, that's right, when you got ready to bomb, drop the bombs, I'll open my door. And he says, all the rest of them will open theirs. They don't want to go any further than I do. That was his comment. It was real terse, but, that's the way we... And we banked, turned rather than formation and that, got back. And it was real exciting. And the pilot was really excited when we got through, because our first mission, everything happened, and the big thing was we lost that lead ship.
Do you remember, was it a sobering event, this first mission, or did it make you more excited about it? I mean, how did you feel after this first mission then?
Oh, I thought the crew as a whole, we thought we could handle it. As simple as that. But they all looked at me every time they come to this. But Jake, it's no game.
How many missions did you fly?
I got it. We shot down on our 18th mission.
18th. I don't know if you're going to remember all 18 missions, but
no.
were there missions that stand out in your mind for one reason or another?
Well, we went to Frankfurt. We went someplace deep in Germany again on a mission. And the day before, I wasn't feeling too good, but I didn't want to crap out. And of course, I didn't know what the mission's going to be, but found out in briefing, I think it was Frankfurt we're going to. On the return of that mission, we were jumped by fighters. And I was airsick. I didn't care if school kept or not, if they shot me down or not. The co-pilot was hollering at me. The pilot was trying to tell the co-pilot, shut up, we don't need that kind of comfort. I remember that one, and they do too, and they all laughed about it when we sat down in prison camp. By the way, the four officers ended up in the same prison camp, Stalag One. But
you're coming back from Frankfurt just airsick and jumped by fighters. What happened?
Well, we got through it. They wanted me to fire my guns. I think we were in an F model. And some of our F models, on all our F models, the Navigator had at least one 50 caliber bomb gun.
On the side?
Some of them had, on the side. And some of them had two. One here, a little further ahead. This one's a little bit further back. The top turret to tell us where the fighters are from, where we're going to use them.
Were you able to fire the guns?
Oh, yeah. I fought. After we dropped the bombs at Frankfurt, I felt kind of like I wanted to throw up or something. I don't know. The bank, the airplane, and that even made me sick. By the way, I was air sick a lot of times when I was flying. And then riding here, an airplane going like this, it took me a lot of hours before I got used to that.
Was it a rare occasion that you got to use the guns, or did...
Yeah, more or less a rare occasion.
Because you're, as a navigator, you're in the nose of the aircraft, right?
Right.
Just give us a job description. I mean, what's a navigator doing on a B-17? I mean, you're in the nose.
Well, after a couple of missions, including that first one especially, they wanted the navigator's logs to see how well their planning was, as much as how well we did. And our navigator's requirements basically was make sure we stayed on course. If we're a lead, we're looting it, and log down different, when we assembled, when we got the whole group in assembly, did all the crews, all crew navigators have the same time or about the same time on their log? That was just assembly.
You know, when you're in the aircraft, now, if you've got your own workstation, is that right?
Right.
And at a table, and you would be working at that. You know, is everyone basically following the lead plane with the lead navigator?
Yes.
Did you find your sort of attitude about this, the whole, about the missions evolving over time? You know, it was pretty, kind of exciting in the first, but the longer you went, the more airplanes shot down, more crews lost. Were you kind of, was there any kind of change in attitude on your part?
In a sense, yes. You got, let's say you get tighter, and the whole crew get tighter, and we kid around and everything else, but we all recognize the fact.
How did you handle the stress of being in a combat situation?
But at that time, that was it. You just kept going as a group, everything else. And, well, a good example of this thing and how we went, they'd stretch, pull the curtain back, and we'd look at the big line where it was going and all that sort of thing.
In the briefing.
The briefing. And you'd be, and that would go on, especially depending on what the target was. To give you an idea of what we were doing, we got briefed March 4th, 1st 8th Air Force mass attacked on Berlin. Well, pulled the curtain back and showed us target of Berlin. We were going down south or something and come up into Berlin. Anyway, and all this sort of thing. Well, Colonel Witten said, this is what we're here for. This is our war. He got about the briefing and so on. He gave a little pep talk. Well, we went out of there like, I'll darn with the second half and we're going to win. Like it was a football game or a basketball game. Anyway, half time's okay, we're... As my crew especially, because we felt we're pretty well on the way, having going on our 18th mission, and this is when we really did go to Berlin. But that, we always moaned when the curtain come back, depending on if you just, we had a couple of targets over France. Oh, and I'd get shot down by Paris and be free for a couple of days. And this sort of thing, when it got, hey, quiet, this is briefing. Anyway,
did you have growing confidence in your pilot as the mission went on?
I'd say yes, in a way. He was a leader, although he'd ask people about different things. Well, what it boiled down to, he says, I don't know everything. We just looked to him to be the leader, and he was as scared as the rest of us. Mm. He says, I don't like to go on this mission today. But we got us, so let's go. We got shot down in the vicinity of Magdeburg. We're at bombing altitude, 28,000 or 30,000 feet, whatever it was. Flak was getting thick, flak did hit our airplane, but it didn't do severe damage. Then fighters came in, and the fighters really ended up, our airplane caught on fire in the nose or around the cockpit especially. And Quillen told us, gave the word bail out.
That's because
now
fire? Because of the fire?
Partly the fire, but the whole thing from the pilot's point of view is this airplane is not going to fly much further. The bomber and the co-pilot said the same thing. They tore a hole in the front of it, knocked out a bunch of their instruments. It started a, they thought it started a little fire and they weren't sure, and they gave bail out. And about 10 seconds later, the pilot said, I looked at Paul and he's still sitting there. He's trying to get a return answer from the rest of the crew. Jordan, he's up out of his seat and going out. I was sitting in the hatch that goes between the exit door, entrance door, and the nose. He said, we got the order to bail out. I didn't, that's another thing. I did not hear any radio contact bail out. So my phone system was out. And the ball turret heard it, and he came up and told the waist gunners. They didn't hear it either. I don't know what the story is on
did
that.
Did you have a chute on?
Yeah, I had a backpack on. So I'm sitting in that hatchway. He just dumped the bombs. I'm sitting in that hatchway, and the bomb bay door is open. I can feel the draft and everything else. He says, we got to bail out. Then I knew we got to bail out. Jabbar is saying that. So I sidled over to the side here and got on the door and tried to unlock it. Unlock it by reaching the red handle behind me. I couldn't do it. So I turned the handle. Sure enough, I dropped out. Next, number two, I planned to bail out and drop clear of the formation below my chute. So I dropped about 10,000 feet before I opened my chute.
What's it feel like to drop out of a B-17?
I don't know. It was like you got to sharpen the pencil so you crown the handle. It's just routine. I had no qualms about bailing out. I had no qualms about opening my chute. I had a flak jacket on, and I was pulling on the front of that black jacket so it would unsnap over the... They didn't do it. Heck with it. I'll bail out. I bailed out my flak jacket on, tried a couple more times to pull it, didn't open it. So I was going to free fall, and I looked off to the side here, and this flak jacket is unhooked from either side, and it would flow up in my face. And I looked up, and next time I looked up, that ground was rushing at me. And I pulled the ripcord. The flak jacket separated all by himself. It went out there, up like that. And I thought it hit my chute, but it didn't. But by the time I opened my chute, the flak jacket was out away from me because I was dropping out faster than that was. It was sailing.
You know, let me go back. You know, when the plane was attacked by the fighters and the fighters hit your aircraft, did you know that your airplane was being hit by the fighters?
Yeah, I didn't know whether it was flak or fighters. That's why I was sitting. I knew something was up, and I didn't know what we were going to do. I lost communications, and Jabbar's hitting on me. I could feel him hitting on me. He said, we got to bail out. So all I did was slide over and sat on the door. And we've been under attack other times. In fact, I got credit for shooting down a fighter on one. He flew right under our right wing, and I followed around, and the tracers were started front of the cockpit and were going through. Each tracer was five, so between this tracer and that tracer, there were four of them went through the pilot.
You know what kind of fighter it was?
Yeah, it was FW-190.
Oh. Had you ever, prior to bailing out of the aircraft, had you ever jumped out of an airplane and used a parachute before?
No.
So this was the first time?
First time.
And so you opened the chute.
Yeah.
Tell us what happened next then.
Oh, and I opened the chute and looked around, And then I heard an airplane coming by. It was a German airplane that was out there. And I went like this to him, and
yes,
he wiggled the wings to him and kept on going right by me. And then I looked down again, and I was now hanging on the parachute and looked like a long ways down. Then I had one thought, I don't want to get airsick here. I was swinging a little bit. Then I decided to look for my crew. So if you grab the shrouds, nobody told me, but I knew if I did this, I'd be able to turn around in the parachute. And I was. And I could. And up there, way up there, at least 3,000 feet above me, maybe more, 8 chutes. One, they were just little steps. And that was my crew. 8, 9, whoa, where's 10? 1, 2, 3. And not till we got to Dulov did I find out that everybody in the crew got out, but nobody could account for the engineer or the top turret gunner. And the pilot, he got burned up somewhat in the airplane before he got out, and he was hospitalized. But about 6-8 weeks later, he ended up in our camp. And he said, yeah, the Germans asked me too, is he a spy? Did he speak German?
Did they?
They didn't discover him or didn't find him. And Paul said he bailed out. We never found out whatever happened to our flight engineer.
Okay, so you're floating down. You've yeah. just counted the chutes. What happened next?
Well, next thing was I was coming pretty close. I don't know how long I was up in the air there. It seemed like long, and then again it didn't. But, I came down within 100 yards of a AK-AK battery. And I thought before the fighter went across, I could see them things belching up there. At that time, I thought they were shooting at the airplanes above me. As I dropped down a little bit after I finally got my chute open, I thought they were shooting at me. Out to the side here, I went, that's a shells going by. It sounded something like that, a funny whistle. And then it dawned on me, they're not shooting at me, they're shooting at the guys up there. When I landed, two people from I was in a pasture, barbed wire pasture. I found that out when I watched them come after me. An officer from the camp, from that artery, and a sergeant came over. They came to the fence. I'm still gathering in my chute and trying to get it off of me before it went, with whatever wind was blowing, it'd billow up again to pull me on the ground. And I finally got it off, and I got it gathered up pretty much, and there's already at the fence. And I looked over there, and I don't know if I remember if I said anything to him or not, but I went back because all of a sudden there was a gust of wind, and shoot, belly blew up again, you know. Anyway, next time I looked over there, the sergeant is standing with his foot on one part of one of the wires, and he's holding up the other wire, and he's got a gun in that hand, and he's got another one in his hand. And this one looked odd to me. And I watched, by this time I was standing facing it. I had the parachute all together, and the officer climbed through. And then this hand, he gave the officer his gun. And the why it looked funny was, that I have no idea what it was, but the officer handed him his gun, and he took it by the barrel. Then when he went through, he just hung on to the thing, pressed down the top wire, and he was about as tall as I was, stepped over, and they came over to me together. And he says, the officer, he said something in German, and the sergeant said something in English. Stick your hands up or something. And then halt. And so I'm standing here like this as a result of that. And the guns are firing behind them over there. It was funny.
Did you have a 45?
No. I had one issued to me, but I never checked it. I never took it on a mission. Cause I figured I wasn't that good with a 45 number two. Going over Germany, who am I going to... 145 against anything, even five farmers with pitchforks. That was my attitude about it.
So they took you prisoner then?
They took me prisoner and went back through the fence. It was kind of, and the German, the officer says, where were you going today? Where was you going? Kind of a German. And I said, to show you how I felt, I said, you should be able to read it in a newspaper or hear it over the radio. One step further, it was a boot in my butt. That officer kicked me in the butt. So I went over there. I felt, at first I was, it kind of made you mad, you know. But then I kind of smiled. I says, I got his goat. I think the sergeant did too. Anyway, we got up to the, what's called, and the sergeant saluted him, and he went off someplace, and the sergeant with his little, they both had Browning 25 pistols. At the end of the war, when I got free, I was going to get a copy. That's the first gun that was held on me. Anyway, and I did. Three cigarettes. Anyway, he took me to an air raid shelter. And I had to go down the seven steps to the air raid shelter. And I was looking up, the airplanes are going across, and he says, that's a nice picture, isn't it? In English. And anyway, I had to go down there. And when I got down the bottom step, he turned around, I guess, because when I got the bottom step, I turned around and looked up, and I could still see sky. And I could hear the airplanes. I stood there a while, and then I looked down, and there was about 8 feet away, six or seven soldiers in uniform. They were in the air raid shelter, and a couple of them in there were a little nervous. Every so often, the guns would fire, so it'd be bang, 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 bang. Where a lot of times, it'd be bang, bang. Bang, 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 bang. That's what I recall. But every so often, they'd all cut it together. And I was looking at the soldier, and it happened once. And two guys kind of, it was kind of on, I didn't know what it was either. But after listening to other raids later on, the next couple of days, I figured out that was, every so often, they'd time themselves so two or three guns would be firing almost at the same time. And it made more noise and a bigger pause in between. Next thing I did, this moaning is going on up there, the groaning or the noise, you know, from the airplanes. So I started to go back up the steps. I was standing up there looking and seeing those silver and olive drab airplanes going over, and they're just, well, they're not, this is about 30 minutes after I bailed out, and they were still streaming over, see? Next thing I heard, German trying to tell me something, I don't know what. But he had a rifle, and on the end of it, a bayonet this long. That bayonet was about that far from me. So I looked at him, like this with the gun, you know. And I knew he wanted me downstairs. I don't know what, but I did. I didn't see him again. And then when the all clear sounded, that sergeant come and got me. And then I went in a building with him and in an office. And he was talking English to me, and he says, where are you from in the States? And I said, I can't answer that question, Jake. And he said, that's not interrogation. He says, you like baseball? And I said, yeah. He says, well, I got to see the Washington, was it the Senators? Senators then? Play ball. Yeah? Oh, yeah. And that was when I was in Montreal, I got to see, that was AAA then. I don't remember what the team was. And we started talking a little baseball, and Finally, he said, "Have any cigarettes?" I had lucky strikes. I unzipped the pocket and pulled it out and handed them to him. I didn't smoke that much, so I didn't mind giving them to him. And he lit up one of my lucky strikes and leaned back in his chair and he said, "Boss, you're in some..." But what he really said was, "For you, the war is over." I didn't quite understand it. I said, "What?" He looked at me. He said, "For you, the war is over." And he leaned back and took a puff out of his cigarette. And I had a feeling he wished that he was I. My crew drifted and were picked up about 30 miles away because their chutes and the wind blew them further than it blew me. You know, I'd lost a shoe come off this foot. I was walking on the stockings in March, cold streets of this little German town. And the kids all laughed at me. And the soldiers didn't like that. You don't laugh at a soldier, whether it's a German one or American, I guess. I don't know. They were trying to shut him up. And then the women got mad. I could tell that. And the goddamn guys, they got a little bit nervous. We ended up turning around. We walked about a block. Went back to where we started from. And they found the one of the two, one of them was a senior. He found another one he wanted. They had to deliver me whole to some place. It was a place where there was kind of a motor pool. And when I got there, there was two other guys, air crew members. I didn't recognize them or anything. They were in a truck already, and they put me in that truck. But the citizens were chuckling over me being only one shoe.
So where did it go from there?
Well, from there I went to... Our crew said, "We'll get to Germany." Well, way back, we're going to plan to be on a raid to Berlin. Because we were talking about it. We went to briefings on the future. One of them would be a mass attack on Berlin. We don't know when or what, but we'd be part of it. So we were going to be to Berlin. Yeah, we got to Berlin all right. A whole crew got to Berlin on a train out of Magdeburg, Germany. And when I got into Berlin, got out on the platform, I saw two NCOs from my crew. And I waved at them and they waved at me. Pretty soon we were all marshaled together. They said, "Where's the rest of the crew?" We got, by the way, that night, we slept in a hallway someplace. We didn't get anything to eat, but there would be breakfast in the morning. Essen, morning. I didn't know that. Anyway, they did let us get to the bathroom. We came back and ended up sleeping in the hall. By that time, I was ready to pass. I could have slept on anything, and these guys could too. The stress of combat was gone. It was a different feeling. And the next day, we got up and joined about 150 other American troops that had come into Berlin to get on this train that would take two carloads of us, including the two enlisted men of my crew and myself in our club car, and the co-pilot and the bombardier were another car behind us. We didn't know that. And the other enlisted men were also on that train in different... Two other ones got together, and then the other one was... Or the other... They were singles. And we got off the train at Frankfurt. That's when we got to see one another. It was the last time our crew assembled as a crew.
And were you...
They broke us up there.
Were you taken to the Dulag Luft,
yeah, at Frankfurt.
And were you interrogated there?
Yeah, I was interrogated there. And
tell us about the interrogation.
Well, the interrogation was really odd. They had outside the building for the interrogators, they had a rifle of squad members. You could hear them count 1, 2, 3, fired, you know. And I remember that guy was debriefing me. He said, oh, you don't want to have that happen to you. And I didn't pay much attention. Then it dawned on me that was a sign we could be shot. Then it dawned on me they had several of those. They had way too many. It was just a fake.
You'd figure that out.
And when I found out later it was a fake, yeah. Other little things like that to get us. And anyway, I was put in a cell by myself. Four walls, a ceiling, and a floor. First thing I did is, again, go to sleep on the floor. And they woke me up, and I thought, oh, it's time to eat. No, it's time to go to the bathroom. Then I got back in that shell, and I don't know how long it was. Pretty soon they brought me a bowl of some kind of soup. I don't remember what it was, and a piece of bread. I devoured and drank that. And then I got interrogated, and then because I didn't answer right, I'll get you some more tomorrow. So I went back to my cell. Next day I got some more interrogation. Next day I got a different interrogator. And the next day I was back in my cell all day. And late in the evening, there was noise on the hallway. And what happened is five of us guys were being kicked out because they had to make room for other people to be interrogated. And I don't remember if they were all officers or NCOs or not, but we marched down the hall and went out, and we were in the general compound. The next morning I saw, that next morning and next afternoon, I saw my whole crew in this group. We were all in the common thing. Then they separated the officers from the enlisted men, and all officers. We knew Quillen got out because one of the gunners saw him being picked up and treated because his right hand burned and part of his face or something. So he was hospitalized.
Let me ask you a question about the interrogation. The interrogation sessions you went through, what was the nature of the interrogation in the sense of, was it a harum-scarum kind of question, you know, sort of by thugs, or was it clever questioning? Was it? How would you describe the nature of
it? Oh, I thought it was a kind of a bureaucratic kind of interrogation. First of all, it says, we know a lot about you, your unit. Now, I could believe it or not, but I didn't believe it. And they'd ask me something. I'd tell them they wanted to know what my unit was, how many missions I'd gone on, things like that. And how did you find the German defenses? I wouldn't answer that. So, and the one guy was going to get something out of me, and he kept asking me some of the damnedest questions I've heard. You're tripping a truck over here. Did you think the roads were good? Yeah. He just wanted me to loosen up and talk about it. I thought to myself, should I, shouldn't I? I was amazed at the forest. Look out of this truck that took me from someplace in Berlin to the assembly point where I stayed overnight. The next day got on a train. We went by wooded areas. And I looked out. And it looked like I could see for three or four blocks. None but trees. No brush, no nothing, just trees. And I thought, man, they keep their forest clean here. And I was about to tell them that. And I said, no, don't be a smart ass here.
When they interrogated you, did they have any information about you?
Oh, when I got all through, he says, I think your mother's name is... McDermott, I said. Oh, yeah, that's it. That's Irish, isn't it? That's McDermott. They wrote that on the... He wrote that down the... He spelled it out. Not me. He spelled it out, and he got it right. And wrote it down, and I got the card. They put the answers and stuff on. I got that at home. I don't have it here. And... My mother, everything else is typed on there except my mother's maiden name was handwritten in. And I thought, my gosh, you guys know everything. And I found out they're getting county newspapers from the United States through Portugal and Spain.
Well, then you they finished interrogating you. Then did they send you to a Stalag, to a camp?
Yeah. Well, I stayed 2 more days. I come out, had 2 more nights at that Dulag. Then I got on a train with the rest of the officer crew members, Jordan and Jabbar, Jordan and Jake, got on a train, and we were headed off. But they wouldn't tell us where we're going. We had no idea where we're going. We're going to a prison camp now. Well, they did tell us that. And, oh, we were standing in formation one day. 3 ranks. This far apart. The individuals. And a guy came in and was calling off names. The one who was there, which ones, and did he pronounce them right. And one of the guys in the back row, his name was McDonald, come busting through. I was in the second row, hit me, hit Jabbar, my bombardier, and coming through the ranks towards him. He said to him, "What in the heaven's name are you doing here? You delivered newspapers to my family in Rochester, New York." And the guy admitted he did. Then he didn't know him, get his butt back in rank.
That was
exciting.
Who was he saying that to? An American officer?
No. He's talking to the English-speaking German officer that was trying to get us in formation. I think the next formation, he led us out of the camp to another officer, and they took us to a train station, and we started a train ride up to Barth.
So this German officer had once lived in the United States and delivered newspapers. So you ended up on a train. Did it end up in Barth, Germany?
Yeah.
At Stalag 1?
Yeah, then we had Stalag 1. We got off the train. We had to walk 6-7 blocks from where we got off the train to get to the gates of the prison camp. And when I got behind those gates, when I saw those gates, and the other guy said the same thing, boy, this is it. This is hell. We don't know what we're getting into. I didn't have a. There was something final about it that some of us observed in a funny way, and that I sensed it when I said, "What the heck? This is or else." In a way. But I got in the barracks, and it was really brand new buildings they'd built. Before the war was over, they built 2 more compounds as big as our compound, north of us.
So was there ultimately a total of 4 compounds?
4 compounds. South compound, north 1, which I was in, north 2, and north 3. At the end of the war, I'd say we're between 10 and 12,000 people there. About 10,000 of us were commissioned officers, either RAF, Canadian RAF, or American.
Talk about life in the camp. What it was, life in the barracks. What was it, you know?
Did you ever see Hogan's Heroes?
Yes.
Remember that? In an hour's time, they'd have a little stunt, upset the commandant. Well, we had little stunts. It'd take us about 3 to 4 months to prepare them. And sometimes we really got a kick in the butt after it failed. Oh, well, it didn't fail, but it didn't make them happy, so they'd take it out on us. One time we stood out in the rain for roll call at midnight. And we knew doggone well the commandant had enough of the crap of these Americans. So he called for a roll call, identification roll call, where they'd look at you and look at your card. They got a little card file. And if you and that were the same, okay. Out of a couple thousand, or I suppose 1,400 people in our compound, 2 or 3 of the cards had the wrong picture on or the wrong name. I don't know which.
How was the food in the camp?
We got Red Cross parcels, about one parcel per person per week at the best. But in my compound, we had a community kitchen, communal dining room. And people take turns peeling potatoes or doing things. That's one time officers were willing to go peel potatoes. Not only would you get to eat some of the raw potatoes, if you're hungry, you get a better meal.
What did you do day in and day out?
Oh, figure out little stunts like Hogan's Heroes.
Things
some
like
some that nobody'd buy, some of them they'd embellish. I'll tell you one thing we did, just to give you an idea. Every night they'd come by and close the shutters. We decided the last 90 days we were in prison camp, we got to teach these Germans something. So what our idea was is to hang the name of the guard on the shutter. When he closed the shutter at night, it would say, "Fritz, we won't forget you." Okay, how are we going to do that? We had chewing gum. So we practice. Chew gum, stick it on a stick, stick the stick to the thing, and stick the gum under the shutter. Then we go outside and pull the shutter and the guard in the tower would tell us to cut it out. We put the shutter back, but it worked. Now all we had to do is do the same thing with a sheet of paper on it and the name of the guy. So we had to go and practice doing that. It'll still, now that'd take us, I'd say we took 2 weeks to get that down. And then we decided, night to night. Now we did not know Fritz or Mike or Joe was going to come down that side of the barracks. We were the first set of shutters they closed. So we knew they'd be surprised. So the German come over to our, German sergeant come over to our barracks with two guys. One to do the shutters on this side, one to do the shutters on that side. So we will look out and see who's coming down and spell it out to the guy that's writing it on a piece of paper. Another guy's standing there with the stick and the gum. Puts it on there, we shove it out there, and we turn that stick, and sure enough, the paper sticks. And we pull the stick back, and then he closes the shutter, and he's, "Whoa!" You heard. We knew darn well what happened. The guard come up. It's no more silly stunts.
Let me ask you a question. You know, of maybe the 15 guys we've interviewed that have been POWs, they've all described being a POW when it really came down to it as being bored and cold and hungry.
Yeah.
You think that's accurate?
Oh, yeah, very accurate. I would say in my barracks, first thing was food. We lay it at night, dreaming about when we ate someplace, had good food. And I had good barbecue food in Minnesota. That starts an argument. Tennessee and St. Louis has better barbecue than I. That'd go on for an hour or two, everybody go to sleep. But food would come up again and again and again. I'm going to have this when I get out. I'm going to do this. And it all had to do with food. I'm going to have so on and so forth. Again and again. And I would say that for most part in our conversations, everybody thinks that guys are thinking about women. No, not women. When they get back to their car, get food, get back to my car. You know, these are more real to most of us. And, we'd play basketball. We'd conned them into putting up basketball goals. And we got basketballs from the Red Cross or the YMCA. And we'd have teams. Softball, we had softball teams.
Talk about liberation. I mean, how did that come about?
Well, one, on the 30th of April, at midnight or something like that, the Germans marched out, left our compound in the hands of a senior Allied officer, and his promise that we would not join the fight. And on top of that, they left us 12 rifles with 12 rounds of ammunition for each one. We didn't know that till I got in there into Lucky Strike and was sat down with some of the senior officers that was in our camp. But the Germans came in, Russians.
When the Russians,
six Russians came in, horseback, two women, four men, riding big, sturdy-looking horses. They didn't look like saddle horses; they looked like a plow horses. And all of them had bandoliers across their chest. That's their ammunition. Then the army come in. We stayed there. Some of us took advantage and went into town to see what it was like, and then come back because they didn't have anything there. We did find the former commandant of our prison camp in civilian clothes in Barth, acting like a leader of the citizens of Barth, like a
mayor or something.
Yeah. And we didn't know he was there until later. And a guy come back in camp, he says, our commandant, he's in town there acting like the leader. What do the Russians come in? And no sooner the Russians come in than he met the Russians, shook hands, and said, well, what have you. Then some of the POWs, the ones especially that spoke German, and one that was pretty conversant in Russian, told the Russians, that guy was our commandant for the last 18 months in prison camp. And they, and he was saying 9-9. I don't remember the whole thing, but within an hour he was dead. Mm. But
when did
he was a commandant out there, and he was.
When did they get you out of there then?
Oh, about 3 days later, 25 B-17s came in and loaded 25 prisoners to each 17 and brought us over to an airport where we got on after getting some lemonade and donuts. We got on trucks and was hauled to Lucky Strike.
That was in Le Havre, France?
Yeah, in that area. I don't remember where we landed, airfields.
Well, at Camp Lucky Strike, what happened there?
Well, that was assembly point. And I think they had, at one time, they had about close to 40,000 ex-POWs there. And of different nationalities, not just Americans, but French and Polish and what have you. And it was a center place of putting groups together.
Did they feed you, deliver you, all that stuff?
Yeah, and the Germans fed us.
And German POWs?
Yeah, they fed us. Anyway, and they ate pretty well. But we went back, four or five of us went back one day at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon when the Germans were eating their lunch. And they had the same thing we did. But they had to get it all at one time. And the dessert was ice cream. So it had mashed potatoes and liver or whatever it was, and beans and that, plus a couple slices of bread. On top of this, they had ice cream. Hey, we're not going to go without dessert and ate it first. We chuckled.
Did you take a ship home?
Yeah, I came home on a LST, I guess, landing. It was one of those ships they put together to ship merchandise over to England.
Victory ship? Like?
Yeah.
A Liberty ship.
Liberty ship, yeah.
What was it like to get back to the good old USA?
Oh, that was great. And all of a sudden, I was not a hero anymore. I was just one of another bunch of soldiers. I got 30 or 45 days leave to come home for that. And I did that, visited my uncle down on the farm where I was telling you originally I was on the farm boy. I visited the office where I worked for Minneapolis Moline. I quit them to get a job in a warehouse where I was working nights. And they were tickled pick to send me, and they had all kinds of questions and so on and so forth. The whole thing, well, I didn't get to meet everybody I wanted to meet in that area before my leave was up, and I went back to San Antonio for discharge. And then I had an option whether I want to be a master sergeant and stay in the military at that time. That was an option. No, I got to go back to college. I got to go back to college. So I went back home, went and ended up going back to Central Missouri, finished the year out. The next year I was at the University of Minnesota, and this next year I was in law school at the University of Minnesota. While I was in law school, I joined the reserve because they were flying. Remember, I was anxious to fly.
How many years were you in the reserves then?
Well, I got in the reserve within a year after I was discharged.
And how long did you stay in the reserves?
Well, I was in the reserve until I was recalled. I was continually in the reserve, but I was recalled for the Korean War.
What rank were you when you retired?
Major.
Were you proud of your time in service?
Oh, yeah.
And tell me why you feel like that.
Well, it gets back to one thing, I wanted to fly. I think I had a funny feeling I was going to be some kind of Lindbergh, I don't know. You know, I as a kid and everything else, it didn't scare me a bit. When an airplane crash occurred, it was to somebody else. And when the airplanes were shot down in combat, it was to somebody else. Finally, they shot me down, but they didn't kill me. Just